Good evening, everybody. Thank you for joining us here tonight for a panel discussion on the Roots of Behaviour in War update. Unfortunately, we seem to be competing with a free cocktail upstairs, so we're never bound to win that one, and so we're not going to wait any longer for people to join us. This is the 10th event, public event, that the ICRC has held within the conference cycle of generating respect for the law. Obviously, this is a very important conference cycle as we are seeing a lot of violations of international humanitarian law around the world and as we search for ways in which we can try to improve compliance with the law. So that's what we're here to do today with the study that, for those of you who were here last week, I gave a small discussion about our new project, which is actually, we've renamed the Roots of Restraint in War. Which is trying to look at not just why violations occur, but trying to have a bit more of a focus on what actually restrains people from committing violations. I'm working on this policy, on this project with my fellow research coordinator, Brian McQuinn, and with Benjamin Eckstein, and we are in the prevention department of the ICRC. So, for those of you who must remember that the first Roots of Behaviour in War study was published in 2004, and it had a very important impact on the policy at the ICRC. Up until that time, the predominant approach to trying to generate respect for the law was through disseminating knowledge of the war, talking to different groups, non-state armed groups and state groups, about international humanitarian law. But the Roots of Behaviour in War study suggested that there needs to be far more done than just talking about the law. It wasn't enough to know the law to respect it. And so the policy change was to go from this dissemination approach much more into the trying to insert or encourage states and non-state actors to insert international humanitarian law into the doctrine of codes of conduct or of state armed groups laws, and to encourage it in training, and also to try to encourage the formation of compliance mechanisms to punish any violations. And this was the main policy that the ICRC has followed over the last 12 years. But even at the time when this was launched, the study was launched, there was the question that arose, which was that this process of doctrine, training, and compliance mechanisms presupposed that an armed group has a vertical structure through which we can feed this kind of influence. And we were seeing even 12 years ago that there was an emergence of groups with much less vertical hierarchical structure and more groups coming out with perhaps a loose alliance and not this structure. So the question was raised even at that time, what do we do about those groups? So this is one of the questions that the roots of restraint in war will be looking at. And so I'll turn to Brian McQuinn, who has really come up with most of the methodology that we are going to use in this project, and he will then be interviewing our fabulous group of researchers that we have brought together to help ICRC look at this question. This is a bit of an experiment for ICRC to go down this path of having a mix between people from ICRC and people from the outside, from academia mainly, looking at these questions. But all of our people are experts in their field. We were very, very fortunate when we put out our call for proposals that we had such amazing response from all parts of the world. And these were the people that we chose to work with us on this question. So over to you, Brian.
Thank you, Fiona. So before we sort of go through and start talking to our various researchers, it's important that the format we have here is to try to sort of get as much discussion as we can. So we're going to sort of refrain from having everyone do 10, 15-minute talks and to try to make it as interactive as possible. But to begin with, I think it's important to sort of understand, at least from our perspective, how this project is framed. And so it's really framed around a relatively simple puzzle. We see some state and non-state armed groups who have a great deal of restraint when dealing with civilian populations, for example. But we are struggling, and I think these researchers are really on the cutting edge, to start explaining why we see restraint in some groups and not others. And that, for us, sort of frames very simply what ultimately we're trying to address. Because for ICRC, if we can better understand what are the mechanisms for that restraint, we are able to then have influence over those groups, or at least be able to encourage slight changes in those behavior. Now, as Fiona suggested, one of the critical issues that ICRC has always worked on is groups that are vertically organized. The problem is that, as some of our researchers will talk about, increasingly the groups that we deal with are not vertically organized. We see groups that are horizontally organized, loose alliances, as Fiona said, and so they don't have codes of conduct. They don't have these structures that we normally are used to working with. So what does ICRC do? What does the international community do? And so in some ways, this has sort of deeply informed how we are going to approach this research. So two of the research streams are focusing on vertically organized groups, groups like state militaries and non-state armed groups that have those vertical structures that are actually quite similar to state militaries. And so in each one of them brings something quite unique and is actually advancing our understanding even of those types of groups we've worked with for so long. Two of the other researchers are looking more at groups that are horizontally organized to begin to start understanding how do those norms form? How do we begin to start seeing those norms of restraint within those groups? And to begin to start realizing that maybe ICRC has to maybe look at different approaches, different tools and different ways of understanding how these groups create norms. Because we often think of these groups as being unstructured or sort of wildly out of control, but as we're going to hear a little bit tonight, that very rarely is the case. It's just that maybe the norms of restraint are a little bit differently constructed than we sort of often see in the West. And finally, we're very lucky to have Oliver Kaplan as well, who's done a great deal of work on how communities actually can impact non-state armed groups. So often in cases where you have these horizontal groups, how do communities actually have influence? And each one of these researchers in some way has brought something quite unique that makes them kind of on the edge of academia, and in so doing will sort of advance our practice. And so what we want to do is sort of go through each one of them and talk a little bit about how each one contributes to this puzzle that we're trying to unpack. Now, as you can see, we have five streams of research, so we can't cover everything in the world. We are trying to cover quite a bit of geography and quite a bit of different issues, but obviously that we have to be also very humble in what we can accomplish. But our goal is to try to advance as much as possible what we can with the brilliant minds that we happen to have up here. So I'm going to start with the state military, and Andrew, perhaps you can talk a little bit about some of the innovations that you're seeing in some of your research and what that sort of sheds light on as far as groups that are vertically organized as the U.S. state military that you've studied.
And before I start, too, I'd like to thank everyone for your attendance tonight. I know you have other demands on your time. The fact that there are so many people here who are so interested in humanitarian law, the ICRC's work is really encouraging. So I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy days to help us in this journey of trying to figure out ways that the ICRC can best impact outcomes and protect civilians civilians in conflict. So thank you. So as Brian mentioned, I look specifically in my previous research and ongoing research at the U.S. Army, looking particularly at what is the impact of training and military culture of armed groups and how that can impact the preferences and the behavior of armed combatants as they how they conduct themselves in war, how they treat civilians, how they think about civilians. It's quite an interesting military to study. The U.S. military is interesting for a number of reasons. One, we've been in some very difficult counterinsurgencies in the last 10, 15 years or so, some very difficult battle spaces. But at the same time, it's a military that at least attempts to take IHL very seriously. And oftentimes we'll take those ideas of integrating the law into the doctrine, into the command structure, into the rules of compliance within the military. And so it provides for us a very interesting test, probably one of the toughest tests that have been constructed to date, where state military that takes IHL seriously or attempts to, for the most part, not always successfully, but certainly attempts to, is put into a long-term counterinsurgency environment. And how do its combatants conduct themselves on the battle space? And so for my research, what I find is I look at some of the training institutions, and it appears that actually, somewhat to the surprise of maybe some people outside of the IHL world, that training actually appears to have an effect. It actually, more intense training can actually change the preferences, the mindset of combatants, how they think about civilians on the battlefield, how they think about the ways they should conduct themselves. And there's initial evidence that it seems to indicate that this can actually impact how they perform on the battlefield as well. And so as I continue with this research, I'll dig into more about how are the actual mechanisms affecting combatants. What are the ways and the contexts and the conditions under which these mechanisms can impact? To what extent? What are the limits that maybe law has in its attempt to try to limit conflict and casualties of civilians in conflict? So.
Thank you, Andrew. So staying on the sort of theme of vertical groups, go to Francesco, who studies and has historically studied for quite some time, some quite amazing research in Colombia, who in the case of FARC, which is a very vertical organization, has some interesting insights into the role of ideology and various different doctrine and how it plays out within groups and how it does shift the seemingly the behavior of groups. So talk a little bit about how that plays out.
Okay, you know, first of all, thank you for the invitation and for the this job that you are doing, which is so important. As many of you might know, the Colombian War is a very protracted war, and then you have the opportunity to see how do rules of conduct arise, behave, and disappear. Sometimes to be replaced by other ones which are worse or by other ones which are better. So it is very important. Of course, nobody can claim that he or she has complete clarity about this, to understand the factors which influence the development and the trajectory of these rules of conduct, especially in highly hierarchical and structured groups like the FARC. Or like the other guerrilla that I will be studying, which is the ELN. So, for example, you have some institutions which directly influence behavior, like prohibitions coming from ideology. For example, the prohibition to rape in the FARC. If you are caught red-handed raping, then you are due to be subject to the death penalty. But also some institutional devices that can affect behavior indirectly, for example, recruitment. So if, to put the obvious example, these are highly feminized groups. So if you recruit many women as fighters, then probably the approach, the routine approach towards sexual violence will be different than in a whole male group. So going to ideology, of course, not all the things that are written in the doctrine, in the explicit doctrine, et cetera, are operational. There are some prohibitions that are not put into practice because of instrumental decisions or of the commanders, et cetera, et cetera. But the ideology, especially the operational ideology, the way in which people are trained, drilled, etc., plays a fundamental role in the way in which they behave vis-a-vis civilians, and there are a lot of examples about that.
And we can come back to those in the second round. So if you want to sort of think of this as how we're thinking of the norms of restraint, sort of the individual, sort of the peer influence, the organizational influence, and then sort of external or society influences, this works for the two first speakers, where we have all of those levels. The problem is for groups that are not necessarily organized vertically, there isn't necessarily the organization. You have informal groups, informal codes of conduct. So how do those norms form? Because they have those norms. But they're often perceived as being completely out of control or unstructured and all these sort of perceptions that we have. But part of the study is going to be studying some of those groups to see if is actually some of those assumptions. And so I'll turn it over to Naomi to talk a little bit about South Sudan. Naomi spent 5 years there as part of her field research, and so brings an extraordinary wealth of both the Nuer and the Dinka communities and how they sort of structure themselves and how these groups sort of form when they do. So talk a little bit about those experiences.
Yeah, so my research has been amongst the kind of cattle keepers and the cattle guard of the Western Dinka and Nuer, so groups in South Sudan. And these are kind of armed combatants whose main job is to guard the cattle. They are based in cattle camps and they are guardians of their herds. But also with that, the community, they are incredibly embedded in the communities that they come from and sometimes live amongst, but also the cattle often belong to those communities. So they have a kind of defense role. And that's very much how they perceive themselves. But as was said, they are seen as at the margins in many ways. They're pastoralist communities. They are very far from the center of the state. They're very far from the structures of the state. They, I guess, for a long time, we've known that they haven't had a clear kind of leadership structure in those communities, and therefore they often seem unstructured. And there has been a lot of violence amongst them in recent years. In the last couple of years, I'm sure you know there's been incredible violence in South Sudan, but even since 2005 and the apparent peace between the north and the south, there was still a lot of violence, and a lot of that was reported in terms of cattle raiding and between cattle keepers. So it was very easy for this kind of image to be conjured of this inherently violent nature of these cattle keepers, and that they were without order and that they were somehow anarchic. But my research definitely shows there's a lot of order, that there are a lot of there's a lot of restraint in these communities, that there are laws and norms that people are willing to adhere to. And what's really interesting is how that's changed over time, and how that works, how these different kind of norms are negotiated and able to stick, even through times of incredible violence and even through times of state change. And you see institutions continuing over time, whether South Sudan is independent or not, and then becoming, or whether war is happening or not. So for example, since the 90s, one thing that these cattle keepers have had to deal with is the coming of the gun. The gun has become much more prevalent in these cattle camps. And during the 90s, it became very common to own an AK-47, and then in more recent years there's been an incredible kind of range of weapons visible in some of these cattle camps. And that's a massive dilemma of, does this mean the end of kind of order? Because even within a small group, if an individual has a gun, does that mean you kind of somehow lose control and they are empowered to do whatever they want to do? But somehow, and they've tried different ways of dealing with this and kind of keeping order. So you see, for example, different punishments based on whether you kill by other means or whether you kill with a gun. So for example, amongst the Western Nuer, you'll find 100 cows instead of 51 cows, or you have to pay that in compensation if you kill with a gun. So one way of restraining violence through the gun, and therefore somehow kind of keeping it more controlled. Or amongst the Dinka, I've seen even for people shooting a gun in the air, so not at all in aggression, but being fined a cow for doing that, just because it was seen as the kind of misuse of a weapon. So even the gun, the ways that kind of local community leaders and leaders within the cattle camp are able to control these new means of violence and new modes of war, I guess.
Thank you very much, Naomi. We're also very lucky to have the Berghoff Foundation and the team that Basir is going to represent tonight, and Christophe is over in the corner, who's also part of the team. For us, and obviously for ICRC, we deal with a lot of groups who sort of don't necessarily come from either Africa or the US or from Latin America. And so groups that sort of have some sort of Islamist ideology or use that in some ways as the sort of political ideology or the religious ideology which they derive some of their cohesion or their ideas or their visions of their actions. So it became very important for us to also do work in Afghanistan. And the team at Berghoff have sort of accomplished what most people would say is impossible, and conducted thousands of interviews in Taliban-controlled areas, understanding how the various different groups there, both the Taliban and others, function both within their various different alliances, but also with the communities that are interacting with those groups and with the international community on a regular basis. So perhaps you can talk a little bit about sort of your work there and how that sort of plays out in both sort of vertical and horizontal ways.
Well, first of all, let me thank you, and thank you, Brian. I just wanted to say this as just to start with. I know I've said that today to you personally, but as a kid, so I'm a born and raised Afghan, and I've sort of really, during the whole civil war process, so I've sort of grown up in war, and the one thing that's always represented good to me is the ICRC logo. I remember it even as a kid, and so it's an incredible pleasure to be here among that and to contribute to the great objectives that you're trying to achieve. Having said that, I think it's a little unfair because I'm representing the team, but we're working in Afghanistan since 2003. I have really joined the team in the last 2 years, but we have another colleague who is not here today, Jan Kula, and Christoph Gostany, who's sitting over there. They have really pioneered this method of mixed method approach, what we call, because we as a team do not believe in this Chinese wall between qualitative and quantitative analysis. So where we actually go, where we do our surveys and our quantitative surveys, we also really collect detailed profiles of all the levels that we go in to research. So that will be villages and a cluster of villages and then at the district level. So we really collect detailed socio-political and demographic information, all of that, so that we really know what the context is. We've conducted this research in three provinces in the north, north Afghanistan. That includes 25 districts. In 2003, we had a small set of districts, but then from 2010 onwards, we really have this 25 districts that amounts to about 254 villages, and about 10% of those villages are completely controlled by the Taliban, mainly, so not really the state, and another 15% of them are hugely contested contested areas. We just wanted to sort of put that out there that even in very difficult context, such as Afghanistan, it is actually possible to do this research. Of course, the team had to go through incredible pain in order to make sure that the quality of the data, and there's a long story, I don't want to take everybody's time there, but there are a lot of complications in terms of, and we're very lucky because we have a local partner who's helping us in that survey, and so a lot goes into negotiating access to these villages and security guarantees and so on, and I think at the end we got what we aim to achieve, despite an incredibly complex context that I think is pretty impressive in. That is, of course, credit to you guys, not to.
Thank you. So the sort of last person to speak, if we sort of did the two vertical and two horizontal, and obviously this is a continuum and groups fall between these things, is Oliver's work and his book it's actually this year, isn't it, coming out with Cambridge Press, looking at how communities can impact groups. And we often focus about how the international community focuses on changing the perspectives and the behavior of group, but often the role of communities is not fully explored. And so this is a little bit of Oliver's work. I'm going to cut on the other side of you. Just talk a little bit about how that's played out.
Thanks. I'd just like to say it's a real honor to be here and to be able to share my findings and our findings with you all. And I've done a lot of work in Colombia in particular, and I've come across a number of communities that have had support from the Red Cross and the ICRC, and I know they were always grateful for that support. So it's really a pleasure to be here to share with you. And so the main focus of my research has been looking at a problem that civilians in conflict zones often find themselves in, and that is that they get caught between multiple armed actors or one armed actor, and they often don't have outside support. And the question arises, what are they able to do? And in particular, what are they able to do organizationally and nonviolently? So without taking up arms, without becoming an arms bearer or a combatant where there may be greater justification to target them. And so I look at these organizational procedures, and what I've found in my research is that the better organized communities are, primarily I've done this in Colombia, but looked at other countries as well, the better organized they are, the less violence they tend to suffer. And so then I've tried to trace out what some of the organizational mechanisms are at play. And when you think about this, this is really a remarkable puzzle, and it's not obvious because these unarmed civilians are essentially up against heavily armed and often heavily violent prone combatants. And so the question is, how are they able to do this, and how are they able to protect themselves? And really, it comes down to this variation in the social landscape. And I've documented a few ways that this happens. And one of the arguments I've made is that in some cases, civilians are able to, what I call, nudge armed groups or try to push them in the right direction to reform some of their norms. And I argue that they're able to do this in cases, I know there are even some cases where the ICRC can't reach, even though the ICRC has, in fact, quite a broad reach compared to many other humanitarian organizations. But even in some of those cases, the ICRC is not able to reach or push the principles of IHL, and you see communities themselves trying to push beneficial norms within armed groups and trying to play on the fissures and ruptures within armed groups to get the less violent members of those groups to have greater power. And they often can do this by protesting or sending some strong collective signal that they're not happy with how they're being treated by armed groups, and then therefore trying to nudge them in a better direction. Another way that I've seen in terms of a causal mechanism would be how different communities have vouched for people who are under threat. So using the community to generate credible information to verify whether someone is, for example, threatened as being a collaborator or not, and trying to clear their good name or at least buy them a second chance. And so I've done some various empirical tests of these different processes, and really one of the challenges that this research faces and why this is also not obvious is that conflict itself can shape community structures as well, right? And so you can see community, if you see communities working to try to protect themselves and you see it looks like it's successful, the question is whether or not they were just happen to be in peaceful conditions or whether they actually had a history of violence and yet were somehow able to deal with that. And so as part of the field work that I did in Colombia, and also the historical works, I really went back and tried to understand the history. And I went back over 60-year period to try to figure out where do local institutions arise, and is that driven by the conflict or not? And the thing that I could tell is that, if anything, these local community organizations, for example, community councils, are, if anything, in places that historically had more conflict, not less conflict. And so, in fact, these communities are operating in places that were not just safe, you know, safe neighborhoods, but actually under a threat of violence. And so, as I mentioned, this is a phenomenon that I became very surprised to see occurring in many countries, not just Colombia. But I mean, if you read the newspaper carefully, you end up seeing examples around the world on all continents of civilians nonviolently working for self-protection. And you know, the nice thing about being able to share this with the ICRC is the Protection of Civilian Populations group that you have here is really, you know, at the forefront of this. And I think that some of my research would hopefully have some helpful implications, both how the ICRC can support communities that are trying to do this kind of work. And also, I think the ICRC could learn some lessons about how communities have managed on their own. A lot of these communities have positioned themselves as neutral, either overtly or more quietly. And it's a real interesting question that they're kind of in some ways mimicking an ICRC approach, but how do they actually go about doing this in some cases differently than what the ICRC is doing? And so I think there are a lot of lessons to exchange.
Thank you very much, Oliver. So we're just going to do one more round quickly of questions, and then we'll throw it to the audience. Andrew, just we'll go around. One of the things that your research starts to suggest, and this is really important for our FAS, which is the people in ICRC who directly engage with military armed forces, is do we have yet some ideas or some clues as to which parts of, as you said, the more intense training seems to have a greater impact on the perceptions. Do you have a sense yet of which elements of that actually become more critical than others?
So it's a great question, and in that sense it's sort of the key question, right, that not only does ICRC want to know, but many armed military groups around the world for how can they better train their members to behave better on the battlefield while still conducting themselves honorably. And so through surveys with a number of U.S. Army personnel and interviews and conducting focus groups with U.S. Army personnel, I was able to really try to get inside their minds and ask them, you know, what are the influences, what are the things that have most impacted them in shaping how they fight on the battlefield and how they think about civilians and how they conduct themselves. They said that many of the soldiers said the Army does a lot of things well. Some of the things it doesn't do quite so well is the sort of standard, typical training by PowerPoint. They have a term for it in the military. It's called death by PowerPoint. And I'm sure as students, for those of you who are students, you know what this is, right? You're sitting in a lecture, the professor is blathering on, and you know, within 10 minutes, you lose focus and sure got it. And unfortunately, that oftentimes this is how IHL is taught to students. It's just, you know, a set of principles, particularly for members of the American military. It doesn't apply to them directly. IHL only applies to the UCMJ through their military code of justice. And it's sort of abstract. You know, they got it, sounds nice, but it really doesn't have very much impact on them. What does have an impact on them, though, is actually talking to interacting with soldiers, other soldiers who have been in that context, who understand what it's like to be at war, to be under fire, to have lost troops, and to know, to have them tell them what's the right thing to do and why. And oftentimes for the U.S. military, it's because it's this social identity that they try to inculcate, that they perform better than that, that they, it's sort of this idea of the warrior's honor, idea from years past, that it's this idea that as warriors, they conduct themselves honorably. The Army does a fairly good job of trying to inculcate it, or at least explicitly doing so. Some cases it works, some cases it does not. But the soldiers have said that it's this idea of having interactive training, that it works with other soldiers, is involved in scenarios, involved in exercises, that's really integrated into the way that they train and think about going to war. That has an extreme effect on their thinking on the battlefield. Some of the most extreme cases, actually, that I come across, which really surprised me, they do a number of interactive video online exercises. They do seminars where they'll get the soldiers together. They'll set up some sort of ethical dilemma about civilians. They'll use the interactive video that actually has a video from a soldier who's been on the battlefield talking about what he did, and then the soldiers will have to get together and talk about whether that was the right decision. Did it make sense to them? And the Army even goes so far, and this is at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, they even go so far as to have video teleconferences oftentimes with soldiers who are downrange in Afghanistan and Iraq, young captains, young lieutenants who can link back and talk to the cadets at the U.S. Military Academy about the experiences that they're experiencing at that moment, about why ethics are important, why following the laws is important. And so that really has made an impression on a number of the soldiers that I talked with. And I think as I dig into this further, it seems that this interactive nature of training and this idea of adopting this identity of a culture of ethics, culture of following the laws of war, really seems to have an impact, a lasting impact on soldiers' perceptions.
As you can see, I mean, obviously, most of the field research for this study still has yet to happen. It's going to be happening this year, but there's sort of little clues based on people's previous research as to maybe some of the direction that it's going. Obviously, we cannot decide beforehand what research results we're going to get. But at the same time, you can begin to start seeing why these individuals were selected to be here, because the nature of their research really allows us to begin to start becoming very practical in some of the implications for our work and for how, in the case of FOS, it goes about doing its work and in our engagement. Where do we put our limited resources over time, both with state and non-state armed groups? And it makes me think, Francesco, if I can ask you the next question. This week, as we've been talking through things, one of the things that we've talked about and you've raised a few times is the idea of sort of changing patterns of violence and how that has changed over time. And a little bit of what that tells us about armed groups and about these sort of norms of restraint and how that gives us some insights into maybe where sort of the leverage points might be in some of those codes of conduct or doctrine that these armed groups are sort of living and implementing, as you talked about earlier.
In a war like the Colombian War, which is very protracted and became very horrid at several points, you can see that it's a fact of life that there is variation, despite visions both in the media and theories, et cetera, that all these groups are equally bad or that they are evil, et cetera. You can find big, big differences in their patterns of violence, regarding the type of crimes they commit, regarding the frequencies of those crimes, regarding their targets. So there is a huge variation. And the question is, how can we explain that variation? So that variation is related to the type of armed competition, of course, and to a lot of instrumental factors, but also to normative factors, to the doctrine of those groups, to the conviction of some of those groups, at least, that this kind of thing is not done by us. So there is a normative core there which has to be fleshed out, but which is probably there that goes beyond purely instrumental behavior and that has to be better understood. So in that regard, so for example, some groups massacred a lot and others much less. Even within the family, for example, of leftist guerrillas, some were indulged very much in massacres and others practically did not commit massacres. The same can be said about kidnapping, etc., etc. So regarding that, there are There's a couple of pieces of bad news, but also of good news. So I give first the bad news because the good news can only be understood after the bad news. the bad news is, and of course I'm sure all of you are aware of them, and is that groups can violate their own explicit rules, and they can violate them grossly, and we need to understand why and in which circumstances they do that. Second, that groups can, let's say, operate according to much worse rules in situations, especially of very severe competition with others. And finally, and this is a point in which I intend to put a lot of emphasis, that not all good things come together. So some very good rules that prevent some crimes may boost other ones. So this is a really bad news. But on the other hand, what the Colombian experience shows regarding this point is that groups are permeable to positive influences. So a first example and or a first dimension is politics. So when indulging in some type of crime creates a big political conflict and undermines legitimacy, as we were speaking, not on structural legitimacy, but legitimacy vis-a-vis some of their key audiences, the group can stop committing that kind of crime. So, for example, the blowing of oil ducts by the ELN in Colombia was one of their fundamental, one of their core crimes, actually, because it allowed them to extort companies and at the same time to make their political point regarding oil nationalism, et cetera, was suspended practically in the mid-90s after they became aware that the political costs were huge. The other issue is, or the other dimension is that they are permeable also to ideas, especially when international discourses intersect with their own ideology. So, for example, some of these groups actually have started to create these courses internally about international humanitarian law, etc., creating a perceptible and invisible change in some of their behavior, maybe not the core of their behavior, but some of their behavior. And third, some of these groups would be willing to discuss explicitly, politically, with other actors about their behavior, sometimes even saying, clearly we do not accept international humanitarian law, but let us discuss it, like the case of the FARC, with the recruitment of child soldiers. So there is a real permeability, which in some sense trumps the bad news that showed that things are complicated. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Francesco. Perhaps we can move to Naomi. In these cases, as Francesco explained, you have these codes of conduct, you have these sort of dialogue that you can have with the group over the nature of what those codes are. But a lot of the groups that you work with and are very familiar with don't have necessarily those sort of explicit codes. So can you talk maybe a little bit about how violence is curtailed in those environments if you don't have these sort of formalized mechanisms, but that doesn't mean those mechanisms don't exist and often quite, you know, effective ones at that.
Yeah, and so I think, I mean, one big challenge in the last few years as well has been just the extent of violence that they've seen. So I think amongst lots of these communities, there is a normative code and even a code that's kind of upheld in customary laws and upheld through cattle camp leaders, through chiefs, through local religious leaders, prophets, and amongst the Dinka, something called the spearmaster. But in these times, in these last decades, again, it's been a very protracted conflict and decades of extreme violence. And even in the last few years, it feels sometimes like they've seen everything they can see, from the killing of children to the destruction of property to large-scale displacements. And And in that context, how can you still hold on to a belief that there's any moral limit to the violence that you see? It just seems that anything is permissible, anything will happen. The people who are committing these incredibly violent crimes, there doesn't seem to be any justice. So how in these contexts, there's very little culpability at a large kind of national scale for what's happening in South Sudan so far. So in that context, how can you try and restrain your combatants? How at a local level can you suggest there are moral limits to what you're doing? And in South Sudan, there do seem to have emerged some key kind of figures that are somehow between the national level and the local community that maybe somehow mediate that relationship of violence or deal with it and sometimes challenge it, that they are these local figures who are able to contest the power of kind of violence with the gun. And one thing I've looked at quite a lot is the growth in number of newer prophets. So newer prophets have fascinated people for about 100 years or more, ever since kind of foreigners went to the southern Sudan. And newer prophets are people who have a divinity. A divinity has come and dwells within them, lives within them. They are a vessel for that divinity, and they believe, therefore, that they mediate on behalf of the divinity but have that power. But these are incredibly respected people in these communities. And when the divinity first comes, that will be tested within the community. People will doubt it. People will question it. But if they are come to be accepted as authorities and holders of that divinity, they can have incredible power and sway. And some of these prophets have gained quite a reputation of being creators of violence. So one prophetess, actually, she's a female prophet amongst the Western Nuer who I've met a few times. She resisted government arrest. She's been accused of organizing large violent raids. But she's also created a lot of restraint amongst her amongst people who follow her. So she has reinitiated courts. At the time, there was a lot of revenge between clans and families and sections of the Nuer. And revenge can very much take place against civilians. Revenge doesn't happen against necessarily the specific person who committed a crime or an offence. It will take place against their extended family. Possibly anyone within their family is a legitimate target. So it doesn't matter at all whether they've been involved in the combat. So she tried to curtail this by reinstating the kind of exchange of cattle and punishing that spiritually if they didn't comply. And people have followed this, and she's been incredibly popular. People have gone to her to have cases heard and to resolve them kind of peacefully through compensation instead of through revenge killings. Even in the last year, she's tried to bring commissioners of the warring parties together at a local level, which is something which the international community has obviously been struggling to bring their leaders together. And she's somehow managed to do that in the village in a way that we hardly see at all. These are very important figures, and they do mediate this relationship. They challenge this kind of relentless, uncontrolled violence at a national level, but they also have this kind of community relationship and way to mediate between them.
Thank you. So perhaps, Bashir, if I can jump to you, because it's sort of in a similar vein, some of the research that you guys have done, which I think under the circumstances is quite extraordinary, but beginning to see how there are shifts that are taking place in some of the groups that you're looking at. And maybe you can talk a little bit about some of those shifts and some of the clues that are beginning to show as to maybe why that's happening.
One of the things that really came up in our research is you have these local defense initiatives created in Afghanistan, and this is mainly starting in 2009 when the Taliban insurgency was sort of really re-emerging and really strengthening, and to the extent that at least one of the northeastern cities in Afghanistan, Kunduz, was on the verge of really falling, and usually states states like Afghanistan, but a lot of other states around the world, so we have a situation of limited statehood. I mean, obviously you can't, you don't really have the capacity to then utilize your national security forces, so that being police or the army, to actually fight this. So one of the mechanisms that then is widely used is these self-defense so-called militias, right? So these are local. They're created in areas that are heavily affected by the insurgency. And the assumption is, of course, because they really know the area, they have the local knowledge, and they could fight off insurgents and at the end contribute to local security. And two of these structures that emerged initially, we had a structure called the Arbakis, and the idea really transferred from south Afghanistan to north, and in the south, of course, you have a tribal structure, and there's a historical precedence to these structures where communities organize militias in order to defend the community. The idea was kind of supported by it was mainly really driven by the U.S. military, but of course with consent from the Afghan government. But then in 2000, towards 2011, they started to really formalize, so the Afghan state really started to kind of give it a formalized structure. And so in some of the cases, these former Arbakis were transformed into what is today called the Afghan local police. But even to this day, of course, you still have locations where you have a coexistence of the both, and in some cases you have only the Afghan local police, and in others, the Abiki. And one of the and we sort of picked this up in the research, and what we really found was in terms of some of the key results in relation to, because we wanted to see the effects that these two different groups, because they come from the same context, the same. They're created for the same reason, but in our data that we had collected, two of the key indicators that we, from our perspective, we believe are good indicators for IHL violations is fear of these local militias and the extent to which they are perceived to contribute to local security. And the three key results that we had were that the Afghan local police instilled far little fear as opposed to these very non-formal Abakis, and that they were perceived to really contribute to local security a lot more positively, whereas the Abakis were not really perceived so. So the factor on which they really varied was this formalization. It seemed to really make a huge difference there. The second key result was that the ALPs really seemed to also strengthen local governance. For instance, we have a lot of indicators for how we measure governance, and I would be happy to answer questions, but I don't want to go into those details. But just as an example, one of the things that the Afghan local police seems to bring, for instance, in terms of local governance, is a conflict resolution. Conflict resolution is a huge issue, especially in rural Afghanistan. So justice is a very valuable commodity. And it seems that the Afghan local police has had a very positive effect in the sense that these sort of local development councils that were mainly created driven by the World Bank, copied from other contexts, the way that they were resolving local conflicts. Because it seemed that they actually brought that enforcement capacity to it. But then of course that was still not the case in relation to Arbakis. And the third key result, and that connects a little bit to what Oliver talked about in the context of Colombia, and that is that the negative effect though that these Arbakis have, it seems that it really disappears in communities that are better organized and are more cohesive. They don't then seem to have that negative impact anymore. So the cohesion and the better organization of the community seems to really then moderate the negative effects of these informal militias.
Thank you very much for that. And obviously this has sort of application to a lot of the work that we do in understanding where to sort of access that. Perhaps as the final question before we open it up to everybody else, Oliver, you talked a little bit about, as did Bashir, about how sort of communities impact armed groups, but one of the things that we were talking about this week that I thought was really interesting is how we understand how armed groups perceive communities and the influence that they have, so to flip it around on its other side, and some of the work that you've done to sort of better understand that so that we can sort of open up that black box of how those decision-making and how those norms form and understand those different levels, the individual sort of peer and organizational community, how they interact in reality and in certain contexts.
Right, so I think the key outcome that we all really care about is what are these armed decision makers doing with all these factors that are influencing them, and how can we really understand their decisions behind whether to use violence or be more restrained? And so within the context of my research, I've developed a concept called the sensitivity, if you will, of armed actors. So when are armed actors going to be sensitive or responsive to civilians, for example, or it could be a group like the ICRC, and when are they unlikely to be responsive? And this is a really important thing to know. It really gives us a sense of the conditions under which the civilian population, for example, might be able to have some influence. And so I've thought about this in a number of ways. There are a number of dimensions across which you could align different armed actors. But one of the ways I've thought about it is that looking at sort of hybrid groups, and so trying to identify types of armed actors that could have incentives to target civilians, but with the right amount of pressure, may be able to pull back from the brink and restrain themselves. And so you could think about varying conflict conditions and conditions of contestation. You could think about different organizational structures that either are on the brink of allowing violence or not, and different motivations of what the groups are seeking, maybe the legitimacy of the group, whether they have foreign fighters or local fighters, for example, or the mix of those individuals. And then think about what are the conditions under which civilians might be able to kind of tip these groups just back over from that sort of decision to use violence or not. And so one of the ways I've looked at this in terms of outcomes is just how do civilian organizational structures and capacity correlate with levels of violence. And so sort of in a statistical sense, you can see the conditions under which that's true. And as you see the intensity of conflict or combat increase, it becomes harder, though not impossible, for civilians to exert some influence. But one of the more interesting ways to do this is to kind of just ask people. So why if you're an armed actor, why would you change your mind or not? And so this is in fact what I did. In Colombia, I went and interviewed a variety of ex-combatants from the right-wing paramilitary groups to the more left-wing insurgent groups. And I talked with ex-combatants and tried to understand, well, you know, I want to get inside your heads and understand how you view different civilian populations and what makes you change your mind about the use of violence. And their responses were really telling. And what they indicated was that combatants take into account these variations in civilian community capacity and collective action capacity. And so what they would tell me are things like, when there's an organized community, they would view it much differently than just a single civilian trying to sort of take an action or protest their behavior. And so a few of the quotes that I had, I mean, one of them kind of floored me. I was interviewing a mid-level commander, ex-commander of a FARC unit, and he said to me, a single swallow does not make a summer. And I kind of had to take a step back, and I didn't even really know what this means, but sort of a single bird in the sky does not signal summer or a significant shift. And he later informed me that this was out of Shakespeare, for example, which I didn't know. And so here I have it's actually, I guess, Aristotle and maybe Shakespeare, but the idea that, you know, a single individual is not something that that unit would take seriously, but if it's the whole community, then they have to take it into account. Similarly, I went to look at minutes where civilian communities kept notes about their dialogues with armed actors. And so these were just like meeting minutes like you would take here, except the communities has someone jotting these down with their meetings with armed actors. And one of the things that came up was, when would a paramilitary unit respect the civilian community? And they say, I mean, word for word, you know, if it's one or two people who are protesting, we're still going to be here. But if it's the entire community, we'll withdraw and respect the community's wishes. And so really, it gets at this collective importance of this collective mechanism to pressure. One other example is these different ex-combatants would say, you know, when a community is protesting against us, it changes the way we think. And so it's really getting at the cognitive underpinning of the norms and beliefs of these groups. And the importance of that is that it's not just, once a group is changing the way it thinks and its norms, it's not just that it's going to treat that community differently, but it's going to carry that thought process and behavior, and it'll likely apply it elsewhere, right? So it's really this internalization of understanding the importance of civilian resistance and the respect for civilians. And so once they've internalized that, in theory, they'll go and apply this to other communities that they interact with as well. So it really change what's going on within the group. And so I think the more we can understand from the combatants' view why they're doing what they're doing, the more effective we'll be as humanitarians.
This is just a sort of a sampling, if you want, of some of their backgrounds and some of the things that they're working on, which we hope gives you a bit of clues as to maybe where some of the directions of the Roots of Restraint in War report will go. And so I think we can open it up now. As we are often reminded in these situations, please make sure you're asking a question as much as possible, which means you actually want to hear elicit information from the people in front. It's been an honor for me. I know many of these people from their writings, and this is the first time I've had a chance to actually meet many of them. So it's been an honor for me the last couple of days talking with them and brainstorming and working out the final design for what we're doing. So it's a very sort of valuable opportunity. So if we can get as many questions as we can, that would be fantastic. So if we can keep them short and sort of punchy, and I will cut you off if you go on too long, just to let you know.
Thank you very much, Hugo Slim at ICRC. Thank you all very much for not just telling us about your work, but telling about it very clearly and concisely and accessibly, which is great. Francesco, can I just ask you one question? You mentioned that there are moments and when people break their own laws. So these might be laws they actually hold by conviction, but they would still break them. Can you give us an example or two of those kind of circumstances? Thanks.
So perhaps we'll take a couple questions. That way you guys can answer them. Obviously, not all the questions will apply to each of you, and you can pick and choose. Yes, sir.
Robert James Parsons, journalist, historian, student of international law. It's in the last capacity I'm here. This is part of my continuing education. The Roots of Behavior in War. No one seems to mention the whole capitalist system that teaches violence, that sells violence, that has persuaded everybody with money to invest that the best way to invest it is in the means of making war. And yet we live in a society, in a whole culture that is based on a cult of violence, from video machines on up to thermobaric weapons. And no one seems to have talked about that. This whole, in short, the mentality that underpins what you're skirting around. Could you say something about that, please?
Brian, and also to Fiona and the other panelists for presenting the research that will be conducted. If I may, I have a little methodological question I wanted to throw off. Sorry, Brian, I couldn't resist. No, just listening to you all now, it got me thinking about these norms of restraints. How will you operationalize that kind of a notion in the research? Put differently, how can you distinguish the non-event? So Francisco was saying sometimes there was a massacre and sometimes there isn't. How can you then say, okay, that non-event, the non-massacre, is actually related to some sort of a behavioral notion of restraint. We didn't do it because we, for some reason, didn't want to. And it got me thinking sometimes the research on prevention has this kind of a problem, because it's like, well, if prevention has worked, then you haven't got much to observe anymore. So it's very difficult to then kind of prove that it's because of something I did or some prevention program that it didn't happen. So to put it in one other way, is how much is it about agency rather than what I've also been hearing on the panel, a lot of material semiotic kind of structures that you're actually studying rather than the behavior itself?
You don't get to ask questions.
Sorry, before. Oliver Utah from the Center on Conflict Development and Peacebuilding at the Graduate Institute.
I think maybe, Francis, could you want to start as you've been named directly and called out? Just sort of start with some of that.
So starting with yours, I think that I would give examples at three levels. On the one hand, it may be the case that you have opportunistic fighters who violate the rules of the group. So, for example, in the case of the FARC, rape is very strictly prohibited and sneezed upon, etc., etc. But it happens, let's say it is not massive, but it is not marginal either. So it is not 5 or 10 cases, maybe in the hundreds, during a very long war, but it takes place. So that would be one example. The second example is when one unit refuses to uphold the norms of the whole group. There may be some examples, for example, within the paramilitary, when the paramilitary were in their process of demobilization from the top of the network, they said, let's stop massacring. Even they invented euphemisms. We will attack multiple military objectives, but stop massacring. But some units continued massacring. But sometimes the group as a whole fails to uphold its own standards. Like when, for example, the FARC and the ELN both claim to not attack social leaders. These do not belong to their targets, and even then they kill them, especially in conditions of high military competition. So there are, let's say, three levels and three organizational dynamics underlying those levels. Then the second one, regarding the
proving a negation.
Exactly, proving, which is also a very, very, very interesting question. Probably this concept has to be developed, etc., and it will be part of the research. I think you remember Sherlock Holmes, who says, look, the key element of my investigation is that the hound didn't bark. The story is called The Hound of Baskerville. I was remembering while you were speaking. So if one thinks about the different elements of, the components of patterns of violence against civilians, which are the type of crimes, the frequency of the crimes, and the targets, then you can disaggregate this and start to see what you do not observe. So sometimes the group simply does not commit rape, for example. Yeah? And this is a very important datum, especially in a civil war in which other groups commit rape. Or, for example, if you observe a systematic and permanent difference in the frequencies, or if, for example, the killings affect very different targets. So this notion of restraint can be systematically operationalized. And of course, it has to be pushed further, because restraint has more merits, if I can put it in those terms, in certain conditions. And of course, it becomes a special form of restraint. For example, when you do not reciprocate, when a group attacks your social constituency or your electoral constituency or whatnot, and you decide not to reciprocate. So I think there are elements to transform that concept into a fully operational concept. And your last comment, yes, indeed, there are a lot of elements of the culture of violence, et cetera, but what one sees from the very aggregate perspective is that different forms of violence and war have fallen down in time. So that variable that you say might, in this particular context, might not have full explanatory value. Yeah.
Naomi and then Oliver. Naomi, I was just thinking about, sorry to put you on the spot, but talking about how in the context of reciprocity, where you don't see reciprocity in some cases, as Francesco was saying, as an example of restraint, there were a couple of examples that you had brought up this week about sort of practically how you can actually see that in some cases.
Yeah, so I mean, I was talking about an example of where the White Army in 2014, so the White Army are the newer like cattle defense force, and there was a strong belief that a large massacre had happened in Juba against the Nuer. So their response was to mobilize very quickly, which is very interesting in itself because they are based, they're scattered, they're in cattle camps, to mobilize en masse and move in the thousands in the direction of the government that they thought had carried out this massacre in Juba. But en route, they were aiming for Bor, so that was kind of en route to Juba, the capital, and they were going to attack it, and they did attack it, and they eventually controlled it, and they attacked the areas around that and carried out massive violations of IHL. But in the Dinka villages before that, actually they stayed relatively peacefully, and there weren't at all atrocities committed. They kind of stayed, they passed through, and even there was one incident where there was a bit of a kind of scuffle, and a Dinka kind of injured someone from the White Army, but they chose to take that to the Dinka chief and have it settled peacefully, as opposed to even kind of returning that with any kind of act of revenge, despite then a few days later going on to commit horrible acts and atrocities against Dinka communities. So in a way, that feels like it's a strange pattern. There's differences. Their own behaviour was different just a couple of days later, and I guess it's really interesting to explore, like, why was that the case? Can I keep talking? And just to touch on to this question of, I think South Sudanese know that the current, like, the world can be very brutal, and the current kind of contemporary world can be very violent. The state they've experienced again and again over the last 100 years is they've experienced the state and they've experienced government as an incredibly violent experience, and that hasn't ended. And I think a lot of people like the prophetess position themselves as something slightly different. So she intentionally doesn't want, for example, modern technology around her. She won't accept cattle that have been bought with money. She won't accept certain types of modern clothing. And that has an incredibly popular resonance, I think partly because people have seen the violence of the state in South Sudan. There's a personal experience to them, and they know it's disrupted family life. So I think people there's definitely authorities that are kind of mediating those experiences of violence.
If I could add something, too, just for that last question as well. It's a really important question, particularly in the sense that in the 20th century, 21st century, we've now, as a people, have developed weapons that have the capability for unsustainable violence across the globe. So this is not a flippant question at all. I think the important part about what the ICRC is doing is it's actually making the world sustainable in a world where there's unsustainable weaponry and unsustainable levels of the ability to kill each other. So if you look at the history of the 20th century, this giant edifice of IHL was created out of the customary laws of war that, over the last centuries, millennia really. But really, when you get down to it, those laws on the face of it don't actually mean anything unless the leaders and the combatants who are held to those laws can actually implement them, can actually put them into practice. Without that, these laws are just paper. They're just words. And there's been a lot of political science scholarship over the last decade that has said just that. That if you look at the numbers of countries that have signed on to IHL, signed on to the Geneva Conventions, it actually has very low correlation with actually how combatants treat civilians in war. It's actually quite depressing if you read it. So
where are you going with this, Andrew?
What are we left with, right? So what are we doing? The purpose of this research, of what we're doing, of what the ICRC does, is to look at what happens when you take those IHL norms, those principles, and you actually now pull them out of the ether and put them down into the military organizations, and you train combatants to those norms. Now are you having an effect? Now are you changing behavior on the battlefield? If you're not, well then this whole project is. Should be seriously questioned. All this, everything that's happening in Geneva is perhaps just words. But if you are having an effect, if those laws, those principles are having an effect on how combatants on the battlefield actually are thinking about and treating civilians as they enter into the most difficult context of their lives, fighting for survival, then you're doing something. Then you're having an effect on peace on the world or the treatment of civilians. It's not just words. So if you talk to, you look at what the U.S. Army did, the U.S. Air Forces in World War II, it was, you know, it was virtually a non-issue for, you know, worldwide city bombing, leveling cities, you know, happened here on this continent. It's, you know, to talk like that's almost unthinkable today if you speak with American military officers. You know, when the idea is even is raised by some of the, you know, U.S. political leaders now, the military personnel, it's laughable. And all the generals come out and they say, this is not how we think about civilians. It's not how we think about war. That is due to a large extent because of the principles of IHL that have been seeping into the U.S. military and into its training, you know, over the last few decades. It's, and again, it's not always perfect. There are certainly a number of violations that the military is engaged in on the U.S. side, on many sides. But this whole mindset, this whole framework of thinking about the laws of war really is taken seriously to a degree that it was not a generation ago. And so the only way that we can actually continue along this path as a species, as a people, is actually, you know, in this face of this technology that we live amongst, is to take these principles seriously and to, you know, to really try to embed them into the military organizations for states and non-states, you know, in this world. So it's a very important question.
Yeah, I'll just be brief, but I mean, it kind of extends on what Andrew just said. And, you know, we have to keep in mind that war is made by the few, right? In general, war is made by the few. There are a lot of, there certainly are cultures of war. I mean, if you want to talk about, it could be, if you could view it as capitalism, you could view it as whatever, but there are certainly people out there who are causing harm. And but we have to remember that the vast majority of people are not directly involved in hostilities. And in fact, there are a lot of what you could call, you know, in many places, a culture of peace. And so we won't really want to think about what this culture of peace is. And in fact, a lot of my research has looked at how civilians act peacefully, nonviolently, to try to avoid violence and bring conflicts to a close. And so one of the things I've tried to do is really unpack and try to measure and figure out what a culture of peace means and looks like. And at least at the community level, you can see this. There are different communities that specifically promote norms of nonviolence, norms of peaceful conflict resolution, norms of not participating in armed groups or with armed actors, not getting engaged in denunciations. And this is a belief system. And so I'm not saying it's everywhere, but, you know, to the extent that we can promote this, both within the civilian population and within armed groups and armed actors, you know, that's sort of one of the challenges we're up against, is to figure out how to do that. So
very quickly, so we can get one more round of questions, if I may, sir.
You wanted to reinforce the point. Yeah, capitalism has very violent dynamics. I think the base of your question is you have a lot of evidence, unequivocal evidence. And since I am Colombian, I know that life can become nightmarish very fast. But when you look at the aggregate figures, it happens that international wars and civil wars have fallen according to every single indicator, including, of course, the worst indicators like casualties, et cetera, et cetera. So let's say the argument would have to match with that evidence.
A very brief question. You've been all discussing your fascinating research vis-a-vis the basis of which would be international humanitarian law, some variant that we know today, treaty law, customary, etc. Have you discussed how to approach situations in which the armed groups do not at all accept IHL? And I don't mean IHL as a body of law. I mean, they have a completely different reference framework, meaning Islamist groups, for example, that just adopt a religious framework, many parts of which do not correspond to the tenets of IHL. What are your thoughts on how to approach and deal and engage with groups like that to the extent that is any experience? And in that context, I have to say, I mean, with all due respect to the seemingly wonderful work the prophetess is doing, it's the prophetess nature of it that personally really bothers me. It's, you know, how does one deal with stuff like that, where the prophetess in this specific instance may be great, but there, as you said yourself, there are instances in which, you know, which isn't, it's not the case.
It's a little bit in the same direction. Do you see an evolution where universality is going away? I mean, as in a sense that you have more and more groups who think in we and the others, and we have rules for ourselves and our community, but the others are not part of these rules?
Fran, and thank you all for coming and for presenting your research. I think it's extraordinarily rich. I do have a question in terms of methodology, I guess, in the future. Will you focus on certain violations that groups refrain from committing? So, for instance, will you focus on, let's say, sexual violence or torture or even detaining someone who is perceived to be part of the enemy? And will you set a typology of these types of norms? Because I think that would be also quite rich for us to better understand. Thank you.
Regarding the development of norms for actors who don't explicitly abide by IHL explicitly, but is there still a sense of restraint? I actually have an article coming out in Security Studies, I believe this year, that looks at the Ugandan looks at Uganda before, as the current regime, before it was actually the regime. It was developed at the NRA under Museveni, and the development of the norms of protection, norms of restraint that they developed completely independent of international humanitarian law. So this was a rebel group coming right out of the bush, very little recognition of international humanitarian law or what impact it had, but they've developed very strong norms of internal restraint towards civilians based on the internal dynamics of their own political ideology. So that's a short answer, but I know the panel members can probably speak to that.
If you look especially at Islamist movements, and then of course in Afghanistan, well, you have the Taliban. I mean, if you would ask them, well, international humanitarian law, they squarely, of course, reject anything that is not, you know, that has nothing to do with religion, but whatever that they believe in. I mean, if you would engage them in that kind of discussion.
Which you and the researchers do,
of course, of course the similarities. Now, what I mean is it according to international? Is it an IHL violation to kill civilians? Yes, that's exactly the same as if they would believe, you know, if they would tell you from the perspective of Sharia. But what is of course actually different, and that is where this whole discussion of, you know, the norms of these groups really come into play is for example in one sense, how do you define the enemy, right? So what you would, from your perspective, would be a civilian. From their perspective, that might not be the case. For example, anybody who works for the government, he may be a civilian, but from their perspective, that person is considered to be contributing to the, you know, to the sustainability of the corrupt or unbeliever system or government. Now there, of course, you have those differences, so you can't really. But if you would hold them to the standards, at least, that they would believe in and have a more sort of constructive engagement of that. What you don't have to do is you don't have to always bring to them what the IHL is about. You could talk to them from a window that they understand and that they can't always tell you no, because then that is something that they claim they're fighting for.
What would be an example, just for that, if I may?
An example of that is exactly as I talked about. Killing civilians. So is that really allowed? I mean, I can give you thousands of references from a Sharia perspective, you know, from a religious perspective, that is just simply not the case. It's not allowed to kill innocent civilians. I hope that. Just one more point to the there was a question again, the methodological.
Oh, yes.
Question, right?
Yes.
Okay, so again, because we're looking at one of the great things about this research is, of course, that we are comparing two groups. So if you're comparing two groups and then there seems to be a variation in the behavior, so one is more constrained and the other is not, whereas the overall goal, the initial goal why these groups were actually initially set up is the same, and then you see that difference, so that negation, sort of, you know, that constraint is not really a problem, because you still have got your variations. Because then what is it that makes these two groups different at the end, and that gives you gives you the answer. And I mean, I don't want to go into the details of the models that we have and what the principle. I mean, unless of course there's interest.
There probably isn't time, but just to sort of summarize, each research stream is actually looking at two groups where there is a difference. And that allows for that very comparison to begin to start unpacking why those differences exist. Okay, we are very close to the end of our time. Is there any sort of last comments based on the last set of questions? Otherwise, we will take it upstairs, and I'm sure you'll be pounced on by everybody and asked for the question. Sorry? Yeah. No one's really kind of directly dealt with it around...
We hope to come up at least with a partial typology, but also with a topology. And this is not only playing with words. This means attaching some sort of behavior to different organizational structures. So maybe it is the case, and that would be is one hypothesis. It may be the case that some kind of organizational structure, vertical, horizontal, whatnot, commits different types of... crimes and also restraints in different ways according to the type of crime. And so there will be a typology, but possibly attached to different types of organizations.
Okay, and I can just say that we also discussed today looking in particular at arbitrary killing, at sexual violence, at attacks against healthcare structures, and forced displacement, I think, was the fourth. But then we had lots and lots of debates. We haven't actually finalized our methodology, or we were talking at one stage about harmonization, but now we're talking about cross-fertilization. So, but anyway, they are the areas, the priorities for ICRC that we thought we would particularly look into. So thank you all very much for coming, and I'd really like to give a warm thank you also to our panelists. I have to say, on a personal level, it's been a real pleasure, and I've learned so much this week. We've had a really dynamic group. We seem to get on very well, which is, of course, never a given, but very, very important in such a research project. So they're now going to go out into the field once we've finalised our cross-fertilised methodology, and then they will carry out the research until the end of the year, and hopefully we'll all be back here. Well, I hadn't told them this yet, so this is news to them, at the end of the year to present some of the findings, if it suits everybody to do so. And we hope that that's going to be the beginning of an exciting process of trying to look at these findings and then find out what does it mean, the practical implications of this for the ICRC, because the policy focus is very important. We really want to be able to talk to the way that the ICRC is interacting with these groups and what is the best way of trying to influence behaviour in the field. And so I think it's a very exciting journey, and I hope you'll be, you know, your interest will be sustained throughout. And thank you very much, and now we can go upstairs and have a glass of wine and discuss further.